Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Just want to mention that starting next Sunday, I'm going to have a sermon series on the fruit of the Spirit, which is found in Galatians chapter 5, and I'll be talking about that for a number of weeks. Well, this gospel lesson we had today is known as the Annunciation, or the announcement to Mary that she would be the mother of the Christ child. Some of you might even be aware there's a day in the church called the Feast of the Annunciation. It's on March 25th. If you do the math, that's exactly 9 months before December 25th, on Christmas Day. Well, this morning we're confronted with the story of the virgin birth, or I might say, possibly the virgin conception, which has been scoffed by many throughout history. And in our time, it's scoffed by those who champion progressive Christianity. Old heresies and ancient myths are constantly being repackaged as the latest and greatest attack on the traditional understanding, biblical understanding, of the birth or conception of Jesus. Every year at this time, one of the national magazines, I don't know which one will be this year, will have a picture of Jesus on its front cover with an article that will question the veracity of the biblical story of his conception. The virgin birth is discounted as a myth that's best put away as childish, on par with Santa Claus. We, however, must recognize that any attempt to take away miracles or to deny miracles takes away the heart of Christianity. The account of the conception of Jesus is one of those mysterious miracles that lies at the heart of our Christian faith. To remove miracles will strip Christianity of its power and its truth. And as you know, God is still doing miracles. I know there are people in this room right here who can attest that God is still doing miracles. Well, in this account from Luke, we are brought face to face with a mysterious miracle. Unfortunately, many pastors have lost confidence in the Bible and have sought to make it easier for their listeners by taking away what they've determined are the hard and difficult parts of the Scripture. And so you don't hear about it in their preaching and teaching. And those pastors not realizing it, their congregations are wiser than they are. When you take away the difficult parts, you take away the parts that are vital to the story. A pastor I know has stated in a newspaper article that the virgin birth and the resurrection of Jesus Christ are metaphors meant to be taken, not to be taken literally. And as you can imagine, that article in the paper rightfully caused a stir and quite a response from other people. Removing the miraculous from the Bible ignores what Gabriel said in verse 37 of this chapter, for nothing will be impossible with God. Every Sunday, in the words of the Apostles' Creed, we clearly articulate the faith that's been passed down to us, the faith of the Christian church. We say, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. When you think about it, that's quite a statement. It's the belief that Jesus is unique among all people who've ever lived, that Jesus is both human and divine. And you'd have to say, that's a mystery. Listen to how the Lutheran reformers wrote about the person of Christ in a statement called the Formula of Concord. Here's what they said. The divine and human natures of Christ are personally united. There are not two Christ, one the Son of God and the other the Son of Man, but one and the same person is the Son of God and the Son of Man. So we believe, teach, and confess that Mary conceived and bore not merely a man and no more, but God's true Son. Therefore, she's rightly called and truly is the Mother of God. Well, at the heart of this doctrine is a biblical statement that Jesus was born of a human mother without the help of a human father. This is all in the realm of divinity. Jesus Christ is truly God and truly man. He's not part God and part man. No, he's 100% God and 100% man. And we have to admit, that is hard to grasp. Our minds can't wrap itself around it. It's a mystery. But throughout history, the church has insisted that Jesus could not be both God and man if he had been conceived in any other way. A number of years ago, I was asked to give a talk about Christmas to the Rotary Club I belong to. And when I was finished speaking, I sat down, and the man right across the table from me said to me that he had outgrown the Christian faith. He said that silly stories like this one about Mary was just a myth, and he could no longer believe it. He said he was now studying things that were much more reasonable. Well, sadly, what he had done is he was putting his reason at the center of all things and rejecting anything he could not understand. He discarded the wonder and the mystery of God. Now, I want to be clear, I'm not rejecting reason or saying we shouldn't ask hard and difficult questions about Scripture and about our faith, because reason is a capacity that God has given to us, and so we're supposed to use it to the best of our abilities. But as we use our reason and intellect, we also have to remember it does have its limits. In Isaiah 55:8, God tells us, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord." There are ways of God which we simply cannot grasp, and that we simply by faith trust God. Mortimer Adler was a brilliant philosopher in the last century, and he didn't become a Christian until he was 82 years old. And listen to why he became a Christian. "My chief reason for choosing Christianity was because the mysteries were incomprehensible. What's the point of revelation if we can figure it out ourselves? If it were wholly comprehensible, then it would just be another philosophy." Now, we have to recognize the only way that we can come to a story like the story of the Annunciation of Mary, this miracle, is we have to come humbly and we have to come in awe. We need to come humbly and admit that our reason can only take us so far. There are truths that go beyond reason that can only be grasped by faith. The conception of Jesus in the womb of his mother Mary is a mystery beyond mysteries. It's a wonder beyond wonders. There's no way that I can entirely grasp it. I have to come to the story in wonder and in awe and humbly accepting it by faith. If any of you here have ever been to the Church of Nativity in Bethlehem, the traditional site believed that the church is built over the site where Jesus was born. To enter that church, you have to stoop low to get through the door. It's a very low doorway. When we come to a miracle such as this one here being described, I think we also have to stoop low. We have to very humbly recognize, I can't grasp it all in my head, but I'm going to come and receive it by faith. Now, one more thing before we look at this gospel reading in Luke. I want to point out there's oftentimes a misunderstanding between the virgin birth and the Roman Catholic doctrine called the Immaculate Conception. The Immaculate Conception and the virgin birth are not the same thing, though people confuse it all the time. The Immaculate Conception is this Roman Catholic doctrine that says that when Mary was conceived in her mother's womb, she was conceived sinless. Well, the Protestant church rejected that doctrine because they said there's no biblical evidence for it. But I just want to point out the two of them oftentimes are confused. Well, let's see what the Luke tells us about the Annunciation. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. Now, prior to these verses here, in the beginning of the Gospel of Luke, Luke tells us that he had done an investigation into the life of Jesus, and that the Gospel of Luke was going to be his orderly account of what took place. So Luke is concerned about history and about historical facts. In these verses, he writes that the angel Gabriel was sent by God to Mary in the sixth month. Well, the sixth month of what? Well, just prior to that, Gabriel made another visit to a man named Zechariah, who was a priest, and his wife Elizabeth was a relative of Mary. We're not sure what that relationship is, but the Bible says they were relatives. And Gabriel told Zechariah that his wife, who was older and was barren, was about to have a child, a son, and they were to name him John. And for the last two Sundays, we've been talking about that son, John. That son is John the Baptist. Well, 6 months later, Gabriel was sent to a virgin named Mary who was betrothed or pledged to marry a man named Joseph. Now, this betrothal is a very important part of the story. If we don't understand what betrothal was in the first century, we miss the tension of the story. The tension where the reader's going, how is Mary going to answer this question of the angel? In the first century, betrothal was a very public act. Today, when couples get engaged, the young man might take his hopefully bride-to-be to a special place, get down on his knee, and propose to her. And it might be in private, nobody around. But in the first century, it was a public act. People would be invited to a ceremony of betrothal. And at that ceremony, Mary and Joseph would have pledged themselves to one another to become husband and wife. And in fact, once they had done that, even though they weren't officially married yet, that wedding would take place a year later, they considered themselves husband and wife. And during that year, Mary would have remained in the home of her family, and Joseph would have lived in his home. There would have been no sexual union during this time. And then when the year was over, there would be another ceremony, a public wedding. A feast would take place. And following that wedding, Mary and Joseph would begin together their married life. So it was during this year of betrothal, when Mary was still living in her family home and Joseph was living in his own home, that Gabriel visited Mary and announced that she was going to bear a child, a son. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." And she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. Now just think about this for a moment. Mary's having a normal day. She has a wedding to plan. She's probably thinking about life with Joseph. And then this angel comes and interrupts her day and turns her world upside down. Her response is quite natural. It's the response of a human being when confronted with divinity. Now, it seems like she wasn't troubled by the appearance of the angel. As you read about angelic appearances in the Bible, oftentimes people are frightened just by the presence of the angel. No, it appears that Mary is troubled by what the angel had to say. Well, the first words he said, "The Lord is with you," I don't think that troubled Mary. She understood that God is present. And was present in her life. But it was the next words that troubled her. "O favored one." Oh, she knew the story of the Old Testament. She knew that people who were God's favored ones were given special responsibility, special missions. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God." Well, once again, this favor is emphasized. And she must have sensed that what came next she would have to respond to. So imagine what Mary must have thought and felt when Gabriel told Mary about her destiny. "And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." Jesus means the Lord saves. "He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High." The Most High was a title for God. Mary was told, she was starting to get the picture now, she was to be the mother of the Son of God. "And the Lord will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Both Joseph and Mary were descendants of David. The Jews had been waiting hundreds of years for the promised Messiah who would come from the lineage of David. And so as Mary was listening to this message, she realized Gabriel could not have been more clear. She was to become the mother of the long-expected Messiah. And Mary responded, "Say that again? What was that again?" No, that's not how she responded. The Bible says she pondered what this might mean, that she had found favor with God, and that she'd play an incredible part in God's salvation story. Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin? How can I have a baby? Joseph and I are betrothed, but I'm still living in my father's home, and he's living in his own home. We've honored the traditions and the behaviors of that time of betrothal." And the angel says, "Well, I'll tell you, Mary, I'll tell you how it's going to happen. God is going to do something that's never been done before. It will be an unparalleled action by the Holy Spirit. What God will do will be unique and miraculous." Well, here's how Luke described it. "And the angel answered her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God.'" Now, this description of the power of the Most High will overshadow you probably reminded Mary of the stories of the Exodus, the people being led for 40 years in the wilderness, because the Bible says they were led by a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. When she heard that imagery of being overshadowed, she might have thought of that pillar of cloud which led the people and overshadowed the people of Israel. Mary knew right then that the angel had announced to her a great mystery. What Gabriel had described to her was a miracle beyond understanding. It was a wonder beyond wonders. And then he said, "Behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her, who is called barren." Followed up with these key words, "For nothing will be impossible with God." We believe that Mary was a teenager. She was probably a young teenager. And Mary must have known that the community that she lived in her own family, would assume that either she and Joseph had been unfaithful to the Jewish customs and behaviors of betrothal, or even worse, that Mary had been unfaithful to Joseph. She knew that her community would reject her, and possibly her own family would ask her to leave their home. That's where the tension, that story is. Frederick Buechner, in his book Peculiar Treasures, wrote these words, "Mary struck the angel Gabriel as hardly old enough to have a child at all, let alone this child. But he'd been entrusted with a message to give her, and he gave it. He told her what the child was to be named, who he was to be, and something about the mystery that was to come upon her. 'You mustn't be afraid, Mary,' he said." And as he said it, he only hoped she wouldn't take notice that beneath the great golden wings, he himself was trembling with fear to think that the whole future of creation hung now on the answer of this girl. How would Mary respond? "And Mary said, 'Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word.' And the angel departed her." The response of Mary is a response of faith. She humbly submitted to God's will for her life. Her response of faith is also a response that God looks for us in us as well. It's a response really described well by the hymn, "Take My Life That I May Be." First verse of that hymn is, "Take my life that I may be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise." The story of the Annunciation is about the miraculous intervention of God in history. When we read this story in Luke, we have a choice to make. We can humble before this story and recognize that everything about God is beyond our understanding, except those things which God reveals to us in the Scriptures. That's what Mary did. Mary humbly, quietly, and faithfully trusted her life and her future into God's hands. Or there's another choice we have. You can discount this story as a myth and reject the claim that Jesus is unique among all people who have ever lived and that he alone is God's Son born of the Virgin Mary. Alistair Begg tells a story about the Archbishop of Canterbury having a conversation with an American actress. And in the course of the conversation, the archbishop said to this actress, "You know, Jesus is the Son of God." And she responded in a very typical postmodern way. She said, "Archbishop, he might be the Son of God for you, but he's not the Son of God for me." To which the archbishop responded, "Madam, either he is or he isn't." You see, Jesus being who Jesus is not dependent upon our opinions of him. The Bible says he is human and he is divine. He is the Son of God, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. And it's a mystery. It's a wonderful mystery. And so do not let your inability to grasp this mystery keep you from believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The question before us this morning is this: has Jesus Christ, the Son of God, taken reign in your life? If you wait until you can figure out all the mysteries of God intellectually, then I promise you, you will never let him reign in your heart. There are mysteries of God that we can only receive by faith. Reason has its limits. The Bible says it's faith that pleases God. And Gabriel said to Mary, "For nothing will be impossible with God." Amen.